I've been.
I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's where he says, 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the alliance. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times, and you get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insoria@gmail.com, and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon, and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is a community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/VinandSori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community connection, friendship, that type of thing.
But, and it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch!
Okay. You notice this handsome bastard right there?
This is our big homie, Seven Dusted.
That's my buddy.
Yep, Seven Dusted, you were in a band? You can sing?
He's a singer in a band!
So... We're waiting on Seven Dusted to send us a live action clip of that because I for one am very curious.
Yeah, I was talking to him last night because he's the big homie. I was like, yo, bro, y'all were in a band, right?
Yeah.
And so he emailed me his stuff. He says, but I can't find it. So
look, you're like so close to him, you could kiss him right on the forehead.
Who?
Seven Dusted.
Hey, buddy. Hey.
I'll pat him on the head. It's over here.
He sang and played bass. Yeah.
You gotta boop, 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 boop.
Okay. He looks like Sean Morgan from Seether. Ouch. That should get you a lot. All right. So, having said that, the first song in this epic DJ stream, if you, dear listener, would like to be a DJ, the process is really, really simple. You get at least 4 songs. There's a 4-song minimum to be a DJ. There's no maximum. Although, if somebody does like a 20-song something or other, we'll just do a whole week. That's like the web week or whatever. But yeah, so if you want to be a DJ, it's 4 songs and then you go. Okay. So the first song up on his gigantor list is Megadeth. Architecture of Aggression is the name of this song. I haven't heard Megadeth in quite some time.
Okay, I'm just putting this out there because we're honest on this channel. You know, we give people 3s or -4s or whatever. I am having a particularly odd day. So I'm not in the mood. So we'll see if these songs can kind of help me out.
Yikes. So there you go.
So Seven Dusted, you have a lot to do here.
Architecture of Aggression, let's go.
Yep.
So it starts like 1 almost.
Okay.
Yes.
Your fatigue. I will bring these in bills from the bone.
Yikes. Oh, here go the bass. Here go the bass. Describing tracers.
Yeah.
It was Architects of Aggression. Yep. From
Megadeth.
Megadeth.
Yep.
Big homie Dave Mustaine. And, you know, it's one of those things where...
That one, I don't think, sounded like typical Megadeth, do you? Or from what I know of Megadeth.
It didn't sound like typical Megadeth. It sounded like regular Megadeth to me. It was just really? Straight up masterful metal. Crazy solo, like always.
Maybe it's because I haven't heard them in a while. I don't know. I liked it though.
Yeah, Megadeth are a ridiculous band. Start because I thought you were going to be hard on it because you usually mean to Megadeth. Go ahead, start. What was your thoughts on the thingamajiggy?
Well, that's why I said it didn't sound like typical was because I think you're probably right. I'm probably hard on them usually. I don't know. Like I liked the way that there was a few different lines that they said. I don't even know what the majority of this was even talking about. I guess it's war. But the way that I liked the instruments of this one. His voice, I'm like, I like his voice, but I'm not like crazy about his voice. And generally speaking, when I listen to music, it's because I really, really like the vocalist. Actually, that's so interesting. I just realized it at this moment. So you know how you look for the guitar stuff?
Yeah.
That's the make it or break it kind of for you. If it's crappy, you like that, right? What's the make it or break it for you? You talk a lot about guitar and bass, but...
Well, I mean, obviously, I'm interested in... Okay, I just fixed the problem, so that won't happen again.
For me, vocal style is basically almost everything.
Yeah, vocal style for you is everything, but yeah. I mean, I...
But I just realized that now, so shout out to Simon Dustin.
I can be ho-hum on the instrumentation if the person... is writing amazing lyrics, I'll still get a high score. You're not going to get a 10 or something if the guitar doesn't move me. But if the guitar moves me, but the lyrics are whack, you're more likely to get a 6 from me.
Yeah, I don't care necessarily if the lyrics are whack as long as the vocals are good and the sound is good.
Okay, so what was your take on what the homie was discussing? What was he talking about?
I don't know. I just liked when he would say aggression. I really don't know what the lyrics are saying. I wasn't watching the lyrics.
Danny says, the only thing I don't like about Dave Mustaine is he kicks out band members that he doesn't like on festivals over religious reasons.
No, not band members. He kicks out bands.
Festivals. Yeah.
He has the authority.
Yeah. You have things like Ozfest or whatever. Like Ozzy's the main band. The name is so huge that sometimes they'll throw festivals like Knotfest.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So Korn had it with Family Values. They run the thing and they decide who's on and who's not. Go ahead.
Tosco, I think you're right. I think that's why I liked it. Because it was more hooky than most of the Megadeth ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're probably right. So
Slipknot Sean in the house. What's up, Slipknot Sean? Good to see you, buddy.
So I liked this one, but I'm assuming when we get into it.
I mean, I think it's probably
lyrically.
It's a lyrical explication of American foreign policy,
oh,
right?
No. I don't know. I saw the side of his face, a kiss to the other side, genocide, time to pay with your ass. I don't know what that means.
I mean, what was it? We saw that thing about Hitler. Remember there was 11 minutes of Hitler's like natural voice or whatever?
Yeah, I know. That was weird.
And I think that was so fascinating because it humanizes a guy that
yes,
we've turned into a monster.
And yes.
Obviously, you know, he was a monster, but everybody knows what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. It's a form of humanizing someone, and you're like, holy shit, huh?
Nobody's only a monster.
Right. So he says, born from the dark in the black cloak of night to envelop its prey below, deliver to the light. That sounds like sounds like a drone, actually.
I thought of Bane.
Sharon Osbourne is also a horrible person, so that's no surprise. I didn't know that Ben knew Shannon Osbourne personally. Born from the dark in the black of night to envelop its prey below, deliver to the light, to eliminate your enemy, hit him in their sleep, and when all is won and lost, the spoils of your war are yours to keep. And so it looks like, you know, and it kind of started off like one. You know, it started with the gunfire and all the rest of it. Then the song ends with the guy describing, you know, tracer rounds and all that.
It is interesting how, because we talk about war versus, you know, like war versus just like a psychopath that's killing people. And, you know, how are those the
yesterday.
Same and how are they different? And
yeah.
It is true. There are certain things like this, like that line when it says hit them in their sleep. Like if it wasn't war. And there was any other situation, you'd be like, what? I mean, you went after that person in their sleep?
Oh, well,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, we were having this discussion yesterday about, like, what was it? The mafia.
Yes.
It was the mafia. And you know, you got guys in the mafia where, you know, you got the soldiers. And literally, that's what they're called. They're called the soldiers. And those are the guys doing the killing. A lot of people, you know, we've said this a million times. Well, probably not this way. But, you know, a lot of those guys... Everybody thinks, oh, you say something to the mafia, you're dead immediately. There are very few guys in the mafia that are actual killers. And that's what people don't realize. It's just, you know, getting people to cross that threshold is extremely difficult. Especially,
it's true, though. You do have, well, not you, but people do have that idea that...
What?
Say anything to the mafia and you're dead.
Yeah. And obviously, it's not something you want to do.
Right.
Like, it's dangerous, but... Right. The you know, when you listen to these guys, because that's my new phase now, I'm listening to these mafia people, you listen to these guys talk, it's just mind-boggling to me, like, the similar, and honestly, I think that's a reason I spend so much time, like, whether
why?
It's looking
why
at the Chicago guy, I'm trying to understand myself, I think is really what it comes down to.
Okay, well, I think that's a really scary answer, because, well, no, it's scary because, for me...
Has anyone ever tried to pay them in credit? That's really interesting.
Pay who in credit?
I'm very interested in that. Send me an email, AT. All right, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So,
I was just checking out the comments section.
I don't... Okay, anyway. So, because for me, if I was going to sit down and watch any of that, like... This is very alarming for me to even say. I would be looking at, like, serial killers getting into the mind of those types of people.
Sure.
But I don't feel like I'm a serial killer.
Yeah.
But does that, you're, are you saying, do you think that, said something about me?
Well, lots of people are fascinated with serial killers. I just think, you know what I think? People like serial killers and mafia guys or people in Chicago or whatever. I think the reason people are so fascinated with them is because we all know that's inside of us. But for whatever reason, we can't explain. We don't let that side of ourselves out. So then when you look at a guy that actually let that side of themselves out and did all those things, it's extremely fascinating because it's like, I would never do that, but I want to know what was clicking with you. But when
I don't think that's it for me.
Go ahead.
I don't think that's it for me because when I think of a serial killer, I don't think of like the concept of that to have like I say innocent blood on my hands because I'm not in a war. You know what I mean? Like, I picked this person for whatever reason. Like, you know, that one guy that was picking, like, literally he was looking for innocent people that would try to help.
You still have innocent people on your hand even if you're in a war.
Yes, I know. But what you're talking about is
you don't have, you don't, no, in your mind, just like most people, if you kill somebody in a sanctioned war, it's not the same thing as killing someone in an unsanctioned war.
Yeah, at least those people knew that you were at war with them. Like, that girl that was walking by and he pretended that he was, that he needed help and she stopped to help him. She didn't know she was at war with that man. She was trying to help him. And then, you know what I'm saying? Like, stuff like that. I think for me, the reason that that,
that
stuff
doesn't work for me.
Is more, like, interesting is because I think that I have spent a lifetime trying to see what's the best ways to protect myself. And so I think when I want to get inside that mind is because I want to know, is there any way to figure out how to make these people tick so I could avoid if something like that was happening?
Yeah, that makes sense.
But,
and but I think your dichotomy about war and civilian killing, I think is just complete bullshit.
I know.
Because
and it probably is, but, but maybe there's people that I love that have been in situations like that and I don't want to condemn them. Maybe there's that.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't condemn myself over anything as far as that goes. But what I'm saying is, whether or not you, to me, it just seems like a lot of people judge their morality of a thing based on whether or not the government gives the okay. So certain drugs are okay because the government says it's okay, but weed is horrible. Yeah. We grew up thinking all this shit about weed and the entire time. The pharmaceutical companies were much worse.
Yeah.
Than weed. But now that the government says weed's okay, weed's okay. So if the government says this kind of killing is okay, now all of a sudden it's okay. But a guy who kills outside of the auspices of the government, that guy is bad. And what I'm saying is that distinction doesn't I don't honor that distinction at all because I don't even know how you can make that,
statement. I don't think that that's true either, though, because I don't feel the same way. It's sanctioned. If there's like somebody that has to pull the lever to electrocute people or they have to inject them to kill them, I'm not good with those people. I don't have a...
You are, kind of, right? It depends on who they're killing. They killed a child molester. You'd be like, yeah, fuck that guy. I'll pull it.
No. Okay. Well, I'll pull it if it was one of my kids. Then I feel like I could overlook all.
Yeah, to me, it's part of society I'm trying to understand. Because you're saying,
although it's okay. If I saw the effects on a child right in front, I'd probably pull. You're right. I'd pull.
You're saying, don't touch that, please.
My headphone?
Well, it's a little bit too close.
Yeah, it was a little too close to the other stuff.
But, like, what I'm saying is, why is government-sanctioned killing all of a sudden okay in the context of war? So a guy dropped 7 bodies overseas. He's going to probably get a Silver Star Valor device if he was in like a... So like...
Okay, I'll tell you why. I think it's
because... But if a mafia boss deploys somebody to kill 7 people, that's not good. That's not okay.
I think it's because when I think of the concept of war, which I'm slowly realizing is not actually the true explanation of war.
Wait, say that
again. I always picture like... You know, in the Bible, when David... When the Israelites went to fight against the Philistines, both parties knew that they were at war. But now, like, I think that I've always had this idea that we had, like, basically holy wars in the sense that the only reason we were looking out for the greater good and the reason that we were at war was because the deaths in war was necessary to bring about the good that the war would have brought about. So the greater good is to go to war. But now, the older that I get, the more that I look into it, the more I'm feeling like I'm not actually, you know, if there's you just killed somebody wearing flip-flops. Well, this is not really a war if you're that much advanced as them and we're over there for, let's say we're over there for oil. That's not the greater good. That's not because these people are being oppressed and we're trying to help them out. Like, so I think I'm still looking at it from that. I don't think I really want to switch my mind about that and see.
I mean, for me, like a mob boss, you know, killing another mobster is less heinous to me than us going overseas and killing people.
Yes.
Because but the mob boss is
doing that for himself. The soldier was doing that for their country. That's what I thought. For all the people of their country.
Well, the mob boss isn't doing any work. The mob boss is sending people to do the killing.
Yep.
So that guy doing the killing is doing the killing to do the bidding of his mob boss. And then the other half of it is his own ambitions and motivations.
Yeah.
So... Why is it okay?
So America's like the mob boss.
What do you mean we're like the mob boss? We kill people with impunity. Nobody can do anything to us. What do you mean we like the mod? That's what I don't understand. Like,
I don't like the- to think about this. I don't like to think about things that I can't stop, and I can't, like, when I stop, I have to stop thinking about abortion, because the idea that every Friday more and more babies are dying, that people right now scheduling appointments for that, it's literally almost traumatizing to me as a person that babies are getting dismembered and that the population is walking around saying, my body, my choice. That's so unbelievable to me.
Yeah.
So I know, can't and now think about it too much. It's funny, and then now, right, I have to think about war too.
Now the Republicans are saying my body, my choice for vaccination. I know. They're saying screw the rest of you guys. I have my own bodily autonomy.
Whatever. I know.
Yeah. Yeah. I hear you. I hear you. I just.
So war is a heinous and horrible thing, but if you think it's for the greater good, then you can excuse it a little bit. But when you look at it and you're like, wait a minute, we were there for oil? Wait. Is that really what's happening? Well, what was behind all that? And you start looking into stuff, starts getting foggy. And
I don't think we were in Iraq for oil. And when I say we, I'm talking about America. Like, it's not like gas prices like dropped down to 4 cents after we went to Iraq. I mean, for a large part of the Bush administration, gas prices were insane. I don't know if anybody remembers that.
Yeah.
So where is this giant boon of oil to America?
Well, I don't think we're going to benefit from that.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. It's like there's like 100 people that benefited from those wars.
That's what I'm saying. That's obviously problematic.
And then we've got people, you know, and obviously we've all lost people over there and all that. And, you know, it's just very, very fascinating to me because all of the structures that the mafia and the Chicago gangs have, the reward systems and the punishment systems internally function the exact same way. So for example, if you go on an op, if you go to target one of your ops in Chicago and you're in the car and a dude is shooting, but you don't shoot, dudes aren't gonna kill you, but your reputation is different. Dudes ain't gonna wanna ride with you, right? Mm-hmm. So like,
yeah,
if you're in an op and you kick down the door and the guy behind you freezes up and doesn't shoot, That could kill you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. In a stack. Somebody freezes up in a stack and you go through the funnel and all that shit and somebody freezes up. Like, you're almost guaranteed to die. So,
yeah.
Like, and there's definitely a punishment system for that. Obviously, you know, your training and all, it doesn't matter how quote-unquote legendary your training is. I mean, I've seen dudes, it doesn't matter how legendary your training is. You're soft. You get in that situation. And again, listen to what I'm saying. Like, you're soft because you won't shoot somebody. Like, they're not soft. It's just that they still have a conscience.
Mm-hmm.
It's the rest of us. We're being, you know what I'm saying? So, and the name of the song is Architects of Aggression. And I think that that's really brilliant because an architect takes already existing material and he manipulates it to bring about the result that he wants, the structure that he wants to see.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, very smart people, when they look, especially when they look at men, young men, and they see that desire for aggression and the desire to prove yourself, because I see a lot of young men are out there trying to prove themselves, and you know, aggression is the easiest way of getting that kind of reputation. There are other ways to create a reputation for yourself, but they're a lot more involved.
Yeah,
like Dorian had that confrontation with those people, I don't know, like a month or two ago, 3 months ago actually. And, like, the kids are still calling him the king.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, because he engaged in violence in such a way that he was honorable and he wasn't afraid, even though he was outnumbered and outgunned. Like, he still fought. He still stood up like a man.
Yeah.
And did what he needed to do. Yeah. And he did it with honor. And so all the kids are looking around. Oh, wow.
He exercised restraint, too.
Yeah. The combination of the right amount of violence and restraint and all, you know, all the stuff that we talk about at home. When they saw that lived out, they were like, oh, my God, he's the king. But they were more impressed with his violence and his restraint. They're not calling him the king because of his restraint. So it's, you know... It's a very, if you are a really cynical, horrible person, getting young men to do shit, particularly getting young men to kill, is not difficult at all.
Yeah, and I kind of wonder, you know, there's that whole, I don't know how much truth there is to this or not, so I'm just kind of like shooting from the hip from the different things that I've heard. Seems kind of like, I don't know if it's from an evolutionary standpoint or whatever, but that almost like in our DNA, the codes of our DNA, our past or our past ancestors are almost a part of that because of the things that they had to do. Like it becomes a part of you, even though, and I think that that's why it's important to know what your history is. But anyway, they used to have the rites of passage and stuff. Like the boys, they would go out, boys, and they would go out into the wilderness, yeah. And they had to be aggressive, but it was aggressive for the purpose of their for their people.
Yeah.
And they would kill the animal and they would bring it home, and then that was, you know, how they would feed their family and stuff like that. So there was like some real positivity to the aggression that they had to have. So, you know, it makes you wonder, is there any of that that's kind of like locked up in our DNA that, you know,
that what?
We don't have that option. It's not like we can be like, well, you know, Dorian gone in the wilderness and bring us back a wildebeest. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
These things don't exist now, like not in America. So the only way for a boy to get aggressive is to join a war.
Or gang,
yeah.
Yeah. Or they get sent to institutions that tell them that their aggression is always bad. Well, that's not good either.
Right.
It's not good either. It's very difficult.
I think I'm talking about the collective unconsciousness, Rebo,
It's difficult because it's not as simple as men should never be violent. You can't say that because now I'm talking as a secularist here, you know, as a Christian, it's a completely different paradigm, but there's bad people out there and there's people that's going to want to do his family harm. Mm-hmm. Like you, we talk about this all the time. Like you, when you go out by yourself, there's always some ignorant motherfucker that's going to say something about your body. When I'm out with you, they don't got shit to say.
I forget that it happens because out so much together.
Yeah, they don't have shit to say when I'm there. So
it's
that sort of, and you know, I project a certain type of like, I'm not a tough guy. I'm just saying like, you project a certain thing like, oh, that dude, okay.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
you know, sure. You still have to maintain at least the, I think, you know, Jordan Peterson said it best. You know, he was discovering the Bible and, you know, Greek words and stuff. He's talking about meekness, and he whittled down meekness to being, it's better to be a warrior in a garden than a gardener in a war. And, you know, that's kind of where I am, you know, like I've hit the point where I'm like, in New York, I definitely had to prove myself. Mm-hmm. I didn't have to, but that was definitely my mentality. My mentality was, you know, mm-hmm. blah, blah, blah. Yeah, all the typical stereotypical, you know, toxic masculinity, whatever. It was about proving myself. And it really wasn't about proving myself to other people. It was about proving myself to myself.
Yeah.
Because I was, you know, we were going to New York, and my brother, you know, my junior, he pulled me aside. He's like, listen, this is New York now. This is not Florida. This is not Palm Bay. Like, niggas gonna kill you, blah, blah, blah. And so he took that as, I gotta warn my brother. I took that as a challenge. I took that as like, okay, so now I looked at it like, okay, now this is the big show. This is prime time. So when I was in New York, like, I was like, oh, okay, blah, blah, because
because
I was like, yo, if I can like eke myself out here and like, you know, stand up here, then I can do it anywhere. So that was my mentality I didn't know that about myself. Like, I didn't know if I had it within me to be able to survive in New York. You know what I'm saying? So I took that as a challenge. I took that as a challenge and, you know,
yeah.
Obviously, looking back now, I'm like, oh, I could have listened to my brother. I didn't have to carry any weapons to school. I didn't need to do any of that shit. I didn't need to have any guns in my back. I didn't need to do any of that shit. Mm-hmm. It was just completely, and all of it was about ego and insecurity and not having a dad and trying to find some way to like validate my, you know what I'm saying?
Yep.
So the other thing that I jumped into was more because I was trying to validate my existence. Mm-hmm. As a being on the planet, you know what I'm saying? But like New York for me was more about if I can, you know, stand up here and be a man here, then I can do it anywhere. And if I can't, I'd rather be dead anyway. Mm-hmm. So that was my,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So anyway, that's kind of like where I'm from. Like, you know, so, but what I'm saying is like, I think a lot of the gang, the older gang dudes, because it was crazy, like, these gang, you know, they'd have these meetings or whatever, these gangbangers, they were very, very systematic. And I asked one of my Crip friends one time, I'm like, yo, How come your superior is what they called him? The head of the gang is called the superior. I have no idea. But I don't know. I'm going to ask. I'm a CEB. The GDs and the BDs, they call the leader the king or whatever. King David. King David Barksdale. And then King Larry Hoover. And then obviously Vaughn. Rest in peace to the homie. But I was like, how come your superiors are never out there banging? How come it's always, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's always young cats. Like, how come the superiors aren't out there banging? And the dude was my friend. So he's like, don't ask me that question ever again. That's he used some phrase where it's like, you can't talk about that or whatever.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah. And I just kind of looked at him and I was like, okay. Because you could tell that he had asked that question, but he wasn't allowed.
Wow.
He wasn't allowed to, you know, whatever, you know? So, I don't know. It just seems to me like the pattern is the same anywhere, whether it's a gangbanger, the mafia, same thing. Like, Paul Castellano wasn't going on any hits. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Paul Castellano was a businessman. And he was a very, very good businessman. But he wasn't out there doing hits and all this other. He was sending Gotti and all those boys to do it. So Gotti, when Gotti turned on him, he was like, man, you ain't on shit. So Gotti turned on him and killed him because he wasn't doing any killing. You see what I'm saying? Go ahead. What were you saying?
Why are the top ones not doing the killing? Is it because they don't want to get put in jail if they get caught?
You don't want to get your you don't want to get killed.
Hands dirty.
You don't want to get killed. You don't want to go to jail. Why would you? It's the same way you're in Bush.
Yeah, but how could you not get? I mean, like, if you're the one that sent them out, why wouldn't you? You know what I'm saying? Like,
why would Bush go? Why wouldn't Bush go to war? Why is it a big deal when the president?
Well, yeah, but that's the president. That's like, how, you can't just get to the president.
It's the same concept.
No.
Yeah, because in the Old
Bush
Testament,
Bush isn't walking around here where we could see him.
Neither is Castellano. He wasn't walking around. All those guys.
Where does he go? He just lives in a house.
Yeah, they're all in Far Rockaway. They're not out there gangbanging and shit. People go to them for their meetings and all that shit. He's not out there.
Okay, well, I was unaware.
They function like the president. They got security detail, all that shit.
Okay.
But,
All right.
Yeah. And he's right. Castellano was trying to get into politics because he had already bought up a bunch of those guys. But,
okay.
Yeah. Well. The president is the biggest gangbanger there is. That is big facts. That's why, like, I didn't have a problem with Trump's, like, mafioso kind of thing. I'm like, at least he has the awareness to know that he's a mob boss. Yeah. He's a mob boss. That's a fact. But shout out to all the bosses everywhere and the ignorants who follow them. But yeah, when do you get the song?
8.9.
9.3. Dear listener, are in the stream, sit tight. Don't go anywhere. We got much more where that's coming from. If you are a lame and you're not on the DJ stream because you're a lame, you're going to have to catch us at 7 p.m. EST. Vin out.
Sorry out.
Gone.